Gas shock springs like on this car trunk are amazing because they apply a constant amount of force, they're fairly compact, and they last. And as approached by Kloud's standing desk, who has a standing desk with no motors and no crank using pistons like this, and I thought, this is an interesting engineering challenge. Because in a car, we know they need to lift a trunk lid and we know how much that weighs, and that part also keeps them in sync. But for a standing desk, neither of those is the case, so I was like, yeah, send me one, because I want to check out how you solve those problems. And after some back and forth, this is what they sent, and it's freaking heavy. Paperwork says 60 pounds, but I weighed the box and it was 60 kilograms. So they sent a few extra bits, which is why that box was so heavy. There was a red ribbon wrapped around this handle that said, attention safety risk. Manual release may only be activated if table's in normal usage condition or columns are extended completely. And I can believe that because this is the pressure tank that pressurizes the cylinders to extend the legs, and with nothing to stop them, they could just fly up and break things. But I just want to see what it does, so I've got this board on here to keep the legs from snapping up. Okay, here goes. I guess it's not pressurized right now. So I've had to study the manual a bit, and this is where you're supposed to pump this thing up. And let's see, do those legs come up now? There's the problem. There's a safety thingy in here. And the problem is I've now pumped this thing all the way up. The manual does mention removing those pins, but did I read that? No. So now I think it might be dangerous to release it, so I'll try to crank it back down. So let's try it with that safety board again. Not the way you're supposed to do this thing at all. And now, let's try pulling those safety pins. And this one. Oh, that came out easily now. Oh yeah. So that push is pretty good. You can see the board is pretty bent. Right now it's set to low load and all that. But it has to lift its own weight. And with the tension mostly released, let's try again. Oh yeah. Lots of force on those pistons. Now the safe thing to do would be to push these all the way in again so I can put the safety pins in there so I can safely put the horizontal parts on these legs, but how to do that with the desk upside down? Okay. Now I can put the safeties back in. So before I flip this table over, I need to lock these legs in place. And that's with an M8 bolt that's supposed to go in here. Now, one of the leg verticals has got a little post sticking out the bottom. I'm pretty sure that's there so I don't put the horizontal parts of the legs on the wrong way. So this leg only goes on that way. On the other one, there isn't such a post, so I can put it on backwards like I just did. But I think they assume I'm smart enough to realize that that's wrong. So this is the end of a leg. By comparison, this is from a FlexiSpot desk. This is just massive. Now if I assembled it on the floor like the instructions say to, I wouldn't have this difficulty getting it off the bench by myself. Okay, safety pins out. That's how high it wants to come. It's got a safety thing. I thought it would just jump up. Now I'm down to 0.0, which is the lowest setting on the chart here. Well, I still got a bit of lift on it. Now there's these two interesting metal ribbons that are under tension, and when the desk moves, they go back and forth, and that's what keeps the two legs in sync. So I should be able to just go on this side. Yeah, I can move it completely like that, doesn't lose sync. So now I've weighted down with a 50-pound weight, yeah, and it doesn't lift, so if I give it more pressure, it'll probably start to lift.
So this is cranked up to 2.2. Still not lifting them. Push it, hold it down. Oh yeah, oh. Okay, keep pushing it. Oh, I put too much pressure on it because it lifts you up. So let's get that down a bit. Nope, a little bit too much still. Balance your weight. Okay, push the button. Whoa! Good safety thing, it doesn't go kabang on the bottom. Yeah. Up to 40 now. Okay, push it. Oh wow. Ooh.
I warned those the standingdesk.com guys that I want to take one of those legs apart, and that might be destructive. So they sent me an extra leg, and it's got these ribbons sticking out of it for synchronizing it.
And if I pull on one of these, it extends, and if I pull on the other, it comes back in.
Now for a two-segment leg, I can imagine how that works with those ribbons, but for a three-segment leg, that gets really complicated. But then I realized it's actually not really a three-segment leg, so I'm just going to put this piece of wood and attach it to the last bit.
And even with full extension, that inner segment still overlaps with this part here.
And while the leg is still rigid, this middle part here is actually loose, so perhaps this part is really only cosmetic and it's a two-segment leg. And that hose goes to the air tank, and if I put 100 psi in there from my air compressor, it extends.
But with the leg pointing straight up, 100 psi is not quite enough to lift it up.
And that's because these gas shock type cylinders actually have a very small displacement area, not the piston, just the area of the rod, so they need a heck of a lot of pressure to push anything.
Now, time to open this up, and I don't see any screws, but I think I can drive these pins out.
And there's nothing to lock the pins in place, but when the desk is assembled, they can't move anywhere. So this is pretty straightforward. This thing with a roller on the end is used for extending the leg. So by pulling on here, ribbon goes around there and extends it. And for pulling the leg back, this ribbon is just riveted to this part here. So it just moves directly with the ribbon. And I'd like to get this piston out, but looking at this end here, it appears to be riveted in place and I don't want to drill those out just yet. But maybe I can pull everything apart this way. But I'm pretty sure what limits the extension is this little tab here, so let's try to bend that out of the way. Ah! Still not coming out. I think it's gone a little bit further because I can see the unpainted part here, but it's not coming out. Oh! Now it's coming out. Okay. Oh.
I think the assembly on the end of the piston is now getting caught up, so I have to back it out and try to remove that.
Uh-oh.
Okay. Probably a bad idea grabbing the cylinder with a vice grip, but that's the only way I can keep it from spinning to get this nut undone.
Oh, no. Is it here?
Okay, I'm at wit's end on how to do this non-destructively, but then I thought, well, time to drill out those rivets, and in the process I realized this whole thing actually now can slide backwards out of the whole thing. So I can go a bit further. Now, when this leg extends, this part here is always kind of halfway in between. So I was looking for some kind of rack and pinion mechanism to keep this at the halfway point, but I couldn't find it. But attached to the end of this was this part here, and that's the sliding sleeve, and it's got these steel rollers in there. So that rolls between this and this, which makes it slide with a lot less friction. On the flexi spot desks, this is just kind of some kind of well-sliding plastic sleeve that does this, whereas on here they got metal rollers, and of course with this rolling, it goes at half the speed between this one and this one, which makes this one move, but that means it's only the friction on here that keeps this on a halfway point, which means I should be able to shove this out of the middle. And with this one in pieces, I'm just going to try it on this and hope it'll be non-destructive. So normally this part is the same length as this. So I was able to shove that out of center. Now, how to put this back in center? So dropping it down doesn't do it, so let's bring it all the way up. Still off center. Okay, I think that's fixed now. Yep, they're the same. And I don't want to just give this bottom segment a good yank, because what's holding it on here is just this little dovetail that holds it on the end here, so I think if I yanked on this hard enough, that would pull apart. So I think that's a slight weakness of the design, because these two little dovetails, I think I could break this if I wanted to. Not that it would wreck the desk, it would just make it look ugly. And I realize now why they added this bit here, because when this extends all the way out, we basically have the rolling surface here exposed, and that's the greasy bit, and there's also no paint on it, because that has to roll these rollers, so it's more of a machine part instead of a cosmetic part. So with this part here, that essentially covers up this greasy bit. And when the leg is fully extended, this tab, which I flattened out on here, normally hooks onto the end of the sleeve here that keeps it from going off the end. And to keep it from coming out if it's off-center the other way, there's these little round things, and that hooks onto this, looks like a washer that's welded on or something. And that keeps this thing from sliding out. And then when the leg is basically all the way extended, these two things force it in the center. And that's really important, because that middle segment, if you move this up and down enough, will work its way down just by a force of gravity. It always happens that way. So for example, on these not so expensive drawer slides, they're essentially a slide in a slide, but you can see right now, this doesn't come out very far, which means this drawer doesn't open as far as the other one, and that's because this has gotten the actual part with the balls in it, it's gotten off center, and every once in a while, I just have to do this. And now it works properly again. There we go. Now, usually when I drill out a rivet like that, they're made out of aluminum, but these chips are magnetic, so this was a steel rivet. And this part here is essentially one of those gas shock spring type things. This old Tony's got an excellent video on it. And looking at the label, it's made in Germany. The adjustable tank is also made in Germany. And then this part is from another company in Germany. So no wonder it's so good. German engineering. Of course, I'm biased that way. And the other parts that aren't made in Germany are made in Michigan. I just placed my metal lathe on there, and I can still lift that one by myself and crank the piston up to the max. It lifts on its own from the bottom, but then as we get further up, the pressure decreases a bit, so it does need a bit of assistance to come all the way up. And it works nicely, but I've just discovered if I try to shove it down fast, it tends to lock on me. I guess that's a safety feature. And it turns out, same thing on the way up, so if it comes up slow, no problem. But now if I try to yank it up, it also kind of locks itself. And with this still pumped all the way up, my weight is enough to push it down, so I weigh more than my metal lathe, but it's a very light metal lathe. For a rolling table that's height adjustable, this would be ideal because it doesn't need to plug in. And the legs are rigid enough that pushing it around on rollers, I told those a problem. Guys, that I thought these legs were too long for my purposes and I'd have to angle grind them off, which is why I have a cut-off piece of flexi-spot desk leg. So they sent me some shorter legs And I just have regular feet on those now because I want to see how low I can go for my purposes. So here's the Kloud frame in front of a FlexiSpot E5, which has just dropped into its lowest position. That FlexiSpot desk takes a while to lift, but it could easily hold two metal lathes, and I should also point out it costs less than half as much as the Kloud desk. And now the Kloud desk also doesn't go as high. The thing is, the FlexiSpot has got three segment legs, and those are actually fully telescoping out, whereas these are actually really just two segment legs, so you don't get the same range of adjustment. But this is my computer desk based on a cheaper FlexiSpot desk with just two segment legs, and it goes lower than that. And actually that FlexiSpot, I altered a little bit to go lower than it normally goes, so in terms of lowness, the Kloud definitely wins against the cheapest FlexiSpot. And if I'm recording in front of the computer, I often raise it. Also, if my back's bothering me, I often go up and down, but it's like half an hour up, half an hour down. And the speed at which this goes up and down is a bit annoying. That's topped out now. Let's see how this one does. So that's about 2 centimeters lower than this one here. And I actually do raise this desk to the top from time to time because sometimes I want a video shot where my head and the screen are in it at the same time. Because of that fast up and down, I decided to swap that FlexiSpot frame out for the Kloud one, but that was less straightforward than it looks because I'd made two drawers to fit exactly underneath the FlexiSpot, and adapting those to fit underneath the Kloud, that took several hours. And the way these fit around the frame is kind of clever, but this part here is quite a bit more solid than on the FlexiSpot, so these guides here needed quite a bit of adjustment to fit around it. Well, I love this pneumatic standing desk, but I gotta warn you, it is quite a bit more expensive than the FlexiSpot standing desks. And why is that? Well, it's not made in China. And everything being made in China, that's a bit of a problem, and it makes me realize inflation was really low from about 1990 to about 2020. But was it really low? Because that's the time where we switched a lot of domestic manufacturing to stuff being made in China. So prices had in fact overall been going up. I mean, every time you look at any sort of service price, it always goes faster than inflation. And that's because governments have been indexing inflation on goods that have been going up slower in price or going down, because governments want to underestimate inflation. They have every incentive to do so. And by switching domestic manufacturing to stuff made in China, inflation appeared lower. But this is a problem because now just about everything is made in China. I recently watched Smart Everyday's video about his struggle of getting a barbecue scrubber made in USA and the difficulty of just sourcing American parts, because the American manufacturing industry, other than for the military, it's just about non-existent anymore. And don't get me wrong, I'm getting on my moral high horse here, but I like my cheap stuff just like everybody else. But think back to the 1980s, like a 23-inch console TV, that was an investment. Whereas nowadays, like, big TV, no problem, let's just get another one. So it's not like we were poor in the 1980s, but our expectations have just changed so much. And on account of cheap stuff made in China, we just have so much more stuff. And is that the right thing? So if you want to get a standing desk not made in China and one that moves up and down really fast, so if you want to buy one of those, I've got some purchase links for those in the description.